lobster fishery in the mid-Atlantic grow by leaps and bounds in the 90s. And then all of a sudden start going the other way. And we're seeing the same thing now happen in Maine. They've grown dramatically in the last 5 or 6 years, 10 years. Super production, thought it was unlimited, but they haven't seen recruitment in 4 or 5 years. And it's warm water. And so we look at that in the fishing industry. We look at, 35 years ago when I used to fight with Bohm, it was over the fact that the glass companies from South Jersey wanted to come and mine sand to basically produce glass. Well, that industry's gone, been replaced by plastics, which has got its own problems. But now the sand mining is going for beach replenishment, which wasn't going on 20 or 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. New Jersey was a supplier of surf clamps throughout the country. I mean, if you had a surf, you went for clam strips in San Francisco, they were probably from New Jersey. It was about a 40% chance they were from New Jersey. They're gone. They have moved offshore and north. So a lot of that planning is the frustration of what are we going to do there. There's some things we can do. Some things we can plan about the sand mining. So that's what we have to work together. The windmill protection. But there's a lot of things that are out of our control. And I guess the scariest part in the last 2 months has been budget talks. And I'm realizing, we want to do away with Sea Grant. We want to cut NOAA's budget by 18%. We want to do away with EPA. All the agencies that I've looked to protect my ocean and my bays and estuaries for the last 20 years. So that's my concern. So we're going to need a lot of you to basically bang the drums. We just can't do it by ourselves. I mean, I've been a volunteer now for 35 years fighting these battles. And I'm going to be 70 next month. And I'm looking for those young people when we don't see them. Now, I know the rain probably kept a lot of the people here because I didn't come until it stopped raining in Tom's River. So, because last year there was a huge crowd here the last time we did this. And I'm looking at a smaller crowd, but I understand that. They're all going to go to Long Beach Island next week.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you for coming. We've been involved in the ocean planning process here since its inception with the Regional Planning Board. And let me tell you why. So, first let me tell you why I'm here. So, what our company does, historically, we're part of AT&T Bell Laboratories. We lay these undersea fiber optic cables that carry 99% of your internet from the U.S. to Europe and to Asia. Most people don't realize it, but New Jersey hosts about a dozen undersea fiber optic cables. That's the actual size. That's the actual fiber that are essentially carrying all your Netflix, Facebook posts. And as we sit here, there's probably data going down to Avon and across to Europe and the UK and South America. You don't see them. They're small, and they're put in a way that we believe is done to protect the environment and the local economy. So how did we do ocean planning 15 years ago? It was some of us 15, 20 years ago going down to Point Pleasant, Cape May, talking to the fishermen and saying, where can we put this cable so it doesn't interrupt your fishing, and how deep should we bury it so you don't snag it? That was the extent of ocean planning 15, 20 years ago. Now there's a lot more activity being planned, going on offshore, a lot more concern for the environment. So these regional planning boards, this ocean planning data portal, just is critical to us to be able to make sure we can put in new cables, protect the cables that are there, and also protect the environment and the other stakeholders that are using the ocean these days. Let me give you one example very quickly. Next Monday, we're actually going to be landing a new cable in Virginia Beach. We have a chart of one here. One of my colleagues, Sydney Sheridan, there has been liaising with the fishing groups down there. The data portal was really instrumental in helping us plan that. We logged into that. We had an intern, actually, from this area, and Sydney and others looking at that data and helping us plan the route to avoid the heaviest scalloping and clamming. So very important resources that we have in the state of New Jersey and at the Urban Coast Institute.
Great. Thanks, Ron. And that's an example. I'm going to ask you to each think a little bit about implementation and what you'd like to see next. Are there any specific actions that you think we should focus on? There's a variety of actions that are called for in the plan, but if you have any specific ideas, I guess I wanted to, as you're thinking about that question, I just want to say, make it clear that this is ongoing activity. In fact, we're continuing to develop data. In fact, yesterday I was at a workshop looking at exactly the issue of ecosystem change and what science is out there regarding to ecosystem shifts, change in temperatures, what climate impacts might have on fisheries. I see Beth from Sandy Hook Lab, NOAA, and others are doing some really really cutting edge work in trying to look at some of those issues. So we are trying to, that is one of the actions in the Ocean Action Plan, map changing habitats of fish species. So we're trying to figure out how to do that. So we're having ongoing meetings with that community, and we'll be doubling back with some other communities as well to continue to develop data and enhance that and continue the dialogue with communities. We didn't know very much about undersea cables until we started getting some of the data, and then we reached out to the community, and that led to actually a collaboration between their trade association and our portal on how to actually map this and show this data in a way that respected their security issues, but also made the undersea cables transparent for other folks who might impact them. So really was a great example of, because we started the dialogue, we were able then to continue to work with them on that. So why don't we start a little bit move it down. Just any specific issues that you can think of that you'd like to see in implementation. Tim, why don't we start with you this time?
Well, I think your point about that there are things that are ongoing right now which we need to address, and which the planning process and the tools I think can lend some help to. Most immediately is the sand mining issue. There's a huge amount of work going on up and down New Jersey. There's a lot of work being proposed in other parts of the Mid-Atlantic. We have conflicts already where the Army Corps of Engineers has proposed to take sand from the Manasquan Ridge and other critical fisheries habitats. And that's partly a result, I think, of a disconnection between the planning, right? There's an immediate post-hurricane need in the response that was chosen, and not as much effort in identifying the environmentally sensitive areas and putting them off limits, at least from our perspective, they ought to be. So there's that issue. There's a very real need to figure out a way to offset fossil fuel energy use and the climate impacts that come along with that, the water temperature, the impacts on the fisheries, are all very real. They're happening in real time. And so we need to accelerate our response to that. Everybody thinks that offshore wind is at least a component of that response. You know, when you heard the person on the film talk about the renewable portfolio standards that each state has, the targets in terms of their percentage of energy that will come from renewable, none of that was based upon some assessment of where they could put it in the ocean. All driven by other considerations. So when they sort of waived these 11,000 megawatts of power generation, 14,000, that's a lot of windmills and a lot of space. And while, I mean, this is a tough question because the alternative energy, the renewable energy, is important to the climate debate, but it shouldn't necessarily come at the cost of the ocean resources. So there's an immediate need there. And then lastly, getting the agencies to, again, as I said earlier, getting the agencies to really utilize the information and to be empowered to do that. I'm just going to echo Tom's, call for everybody to make a call to Washington, because every single program that affects the coast and the ocean, and whether it's NOAA's research or it's the implementation of these plans to the RPBs or the ability of people like Kevin to get to a meeting in Virginia in order to have this conversation, is all either been completely zero funded or so reduced that the programs will be ineffectual. You cannot underestimate how catastrophic the budget is that the president has proposed on the protection and the management of the ocean. So all these things we're talking about all hinge on that immediate debate, and that needs to be wrapped in it. And I think the need to answer those questions, the need to find this balance point between all these different things we want to see happen in the ocean, really provide some immediacy to the budget debates.
Great. Tom, fisheries challenges that you see, particularly that you'd like to see more attention to?
Sand mining is important because we're destroying the lumps, and that's critical habitat. But we also need to look at the reaction between the bays and the estuaries and the ocean. We kind of forget, or sometimes we forget because we're talking about ocean planning, that a lot of the fish, that was their nursery areas in the bays and estuaries. The menhaden that come along the coast, the summer flounder that actually spawn in the canyon and come into the basin estuary to grow their first year. the winter flounder actually stops the dredging at Little Lake Harbor until they finish their spawning inside the bays and estuaries. And so we need to look at that interreaction, and also what happens when we breach at Ortley Beach and Manilocan and all that sand comes into the bay, and then we dredge it all out. So what is the impact for the next 5 years over that? So we need to work together. The cable guys, we've been working with the fishermen, working with us. The drag has never wanted to rip up the cables, I mean, because there's a lot of money both one way or the other. And I used to go, first time I saw the cable boat, which is off Baltimore, in Baltimore Harbor, Bruce Freeman was spent 25 years ago or 30 years ago, we're going to a Mid-Atlantic Council. He says, those are the boats that lay all the cable over the country. And those were a lot bigger cables back then.
Yeah, they were a little small.
Yeah, I mean,
not like the power cable.
We need to do better coordination. Paul Sanford, I think, did the first workshop at Monmouth University on ocean, which is about how many years ago?
Six, eight, seven? I don't know.
It's longer than that.
Right.
We get older, we forget how long ago that was. And we started talking about where we're going. This was an opportunity to do ocean planning, coordinating between groups. Not do regulations, because that's other agencies that do that, other problems. But people get to talking to each other. I mean, I've been dealing with some flounder, and there's groups that are not talking to other groups. They're yelling at this one and that one. I sit at the table. I sat with John Bullock on Mondays talking about summer flounder. I'm going to talk tomorrow with Sam Royce, who's the acting head of NIMS, tomorrow about summer flounder and a few other issues, but mostly about funding. A lot of the problems we have here, the interaction, we can't do without research because we don't know what's there. If we don't spend the money on research, we're still in the dark ages. Black sea bass, in 1992, when we did the plan for black sea bass, I want to know what was really the status of the stocks. We says, we'll get there. It is 2017. We have no more research on really what's happening with black sea bass. We just have designed better models, which is what we do nowadays, because it's a lot cheaper to basically handle bad data. Now, we shouldn't do this with the portal. We should do the information. It is important that we know all these locations. Maybe if those portals had basically had all the lumps and everything put in them. Now, they weren't the maps that Sandy Hook Lab has, and put out for 35 years ago, but it weren't put in the portal in time.
Some of it's in there, but that's a longer discussion. But, Ron, anything specific you'd like to see in implementation, or is it sort of serving your needs right now?
I think it's. I want to make one comment. It was, I think it was what Tom said. It took me a couple meetings of the regional planning boards 3 years ago to realize this body is not a regulatory body. That is still done back in the agencies, whether it's the Army Corps or BOEM. Those laws are still, and they have that responsibility. But the planning board's got all those people together to coordinate and basically compare notes and share data. And the benefit to us was when we wanted to do a new cable project, it wasn't starting from scratch, relearning, studying the same problems. These same environmental issues, impacts, were already basically documented and studied and put into this data set. So, you know, that's a great benefit, I think, to all around. I think the challenge, I guess, for our industry is to make sure some of the new infrastructure, new leases, you know, thinking of wind farms, I'm a proponent of wind, but we can't have wall-to-wall windmills up and down the coast, not only for interrupts fishing and recreation, but we need some cable corridors to get out from the coast to Europe and South America. So those are the things that have to be considered.
Right. Kevin, you want to tell us some of the things that you're focusing on or priorities for you?
Sure. I mean, you know, obviously from the opposite side of things, being part of that planning body, I'm just kind of staffing it, but, you know, kind of feel that all these actions are pretty important. You know, we wouldn't have done any of them if we didn't really think that there was a strong need to do a lot of them. But, you know, I just echo a lot of this stuff here. The collaboration, coordination has been key to this process. You know, getting everyone in the room and actually discussing these issues, knowing who to actually talk to when a project comes in, you know, how do we actually address some of those issues? You know, a lot of the historical data that was out there is problematic for a lot of things, like the lumps issue comes up because some of that stuff was identified years before we identified those as prime fishing areas. And so, you know, they were using old data, and so things keep moving forward. So as we move forward now, it's like we have more data, and hopefully now we can continue to address that in a better manner. You know, it crosses so many different things. You know, as in the film shows, you know, you're from fishing and sand management, just the health of the ecosystem. And then, you know, we go all the way down to, you know, where we're looking at recreational uses. You know, it's not something that's really been addressed. And the coastal states tend to address those things, but the federal government and federal agencies, it's really not their bailiwick of what they're going to do. So, you know, it's how do we get those people that are underserved in these communities to engage in this process and make sure their voices are heard too.
You know, one thing I'll mention, I'll ask Kevin just expand a little bit, because the way they're implementing this, so all this information about their actions are there, is they're establishing work groups now to follow up on some of these specific items. So Kevin's, I think, very actively engaged at least two of the working groups, and why don't you just mention briefly what your working groups are and what you're working on, but there are many others.
Yeah, there's, I mean, across the whole plan, I mean, we have, there's six different actions under healthy ocean ecosystems, and there's over 33 different actions, separate actions under sustainable ocean uses. So there's a lot of different work groups that are getting set up. Some of the main ones that we're working on right now, say marine debris, healthy ocean ecosystems, we're identifying ecologically rich areas and, you know, how that's going to change over time. We're looking at the changes in species distribution. All the way down to our other work group of non-consumptive recreation, where we're actually going to start developing survey work to actually engage with the communities to do that. You know, if you go to the BOEM website where the RBB's information is all hosted, you'll start seeing that they're going to start posting actual dates when there's going to be meetings and things like that. So, you know, most every meeting that's going to be posted on there are public meetings, and you can engage in those. So there may be even direct stakeholder meetings that are announced there. So, you know, that's your best opportunity. Just if you want to get involved, you know, you can contact everyone through those processes. So.
Yeah, it's the Mid-Atlantic Regional Planning Body for those. Again, where these meetings are public, they're continuing the outreach. A good example of Tom's, this is not a regulatory process, is one of the issues you saw up there was the deep sea corals. They use data from the Ocean Data Portal to have a dialogue with the fishermen in the Mid-Atlantic Council using their processes for how to actually manage some of that and protect some of those coral areas while at the same time protecting the fisheries. So that was a collaborative process that used some of this data within the existing framework. So it wasn't a new added-on regulation, but it really was an opportunity for the fishermen to work directly with the council and the managers to sort of protect that resource, which is 28,000 square miles of protected area now under the Mid-Atlantic Council. That's a consensus with the industry on how to do that. Yep.
The other thing is, mostly in government, because you're always worried about the next election, we do short-term planning. And this is really the body that should be looking at what happens 20 years from now, where we're going to be with sea level rise. We're going to have to move all the infrastructure back. We're going to have to build, I mean, there's no ifs, ands, or buts. We're looking at sea level rise. We're looking at houses that are going to be underwater in probably 20 years. I thought it was going to be 50 years, but the amount of water that's now rising, it's going to be less. It's going to be 20 years. So we got to tackle that. The time to do it is now. The time is to coordinate the plan to do that. And that's a great project for this, besides looking at what the short-term issues are, where we put the wind farms there, but where we're going to move the infrastructure back, how are we going to take care of the tunnels, how are we going to take care of transportation, how are we going to take care of the population that has to move half a mile this way or a mile this way.
And we have to think about the interaction between the land and the ocean, which is certainly something we haven't fully got to yet. Now, I'd like to open this up a little bit to the audience a little bit for any comments or questions. So if I could ask folks to just raise their hand, I'll point at, please identify who you are and direct your question to the panel or to anybody specifically that you'd like to. Any questions or comments out there? Yes?
Except they're going to run out of money because they cut the budget.
So does anybody want to take a stab at it? I have some comments. Great. I'm sorry. Introduce yourself. What's your name?
I'm Jennifer Hassell. I'm the
That's great. That's just, that's, we like the citizens most of all. Lovely. Thank you.
So I think the wind farm example that I use, there's two. One was the Cape Wind project in New England, off of Martha's Vineyard. Went in, the developer went in without a lot of planning, without a lot of contact and conversation with the folks that live close by, with the boaters, with the fishermen. About 11 years later, I think two or three court cases, the thing collapsed because it had just run out of money and the power agreements that they had negotiated. So that conflict, you know, ended the first sort of quasi-viable wind project. There's now a conflict off of Long Island where Long Island Power Authority wants to foster a farm. It's also sited inside scalloping grounds and other fisheries areas. So the promise of the ocean planning, I don't think has played out yet for the wind farm siting. But the pitfalls of not doing it, of not doing well-informed, science-based, stakeholder-inclusive planning, I think are clearly there. And so from my perspective, that's a real ought to be a real motivator if given the need to provide that kind of energy to do the process right.
Any other comments, observations?
Yeah, I'll just add a little bit to that. And a lot of the processes for, like, say, wind and other things started before the ocean planning process even started. So that these are very long-term projects, and the regulations that were in place for that, you know, they were already there. And as people mentioned, there's no new authorities and regulations that were set up as this process. So each of those things that go through are still underneath the agencies that were originally doing them. So now it's more coordination across that stuff. I think one thing that planning process has developed through the data portal, and that's been key, is that actually gets all the information, a lot of information that, you know, is used for decision making on the government level, into the hands of stakeholders. So you can now actually go on the portal and you can actually see that scallop fisheries information in where the wind energy parks are being designed. So you can actually engage, you know, BOEM and the states in that to say, well, you know, here's things that were identified previously. Why weren't those taken into consideration? And so, I mean, I think it really empowers all our stakeholders and our citizens to actually, you know, be involved in those decisions. So although some processes have been ongoing for a long time, I think now is the time that actually it's really more engaging for the citizens to get involved. So I think it's really helpful from that standpoint.
There are a few other examples as well down in Virginia. They actually, the Navy talked to the commercial navigation industry, and they rearranged one of their training areas because they realized that it would save the navigation industry, the ports, a lot of money if you could allow it to just cut off that corner, and they really didn't need it for their training. So that was an example where there was a specific dialogue that was set up. A really big part of this, and I think it was in Kevin's answer, is the relationships that are built out. You have this dynamic where people are talking to each other on a regular basis so that you're not trying to figure out who to speak to about these issues, and you have them an opportunity to discuss them earlier in the regulatory process. So you don't wait till the Federal Register notice comes out or something like that. Hopefully we can get to that. You know, one of the examples, I don't think it's entirely satisfactory to the fishing industry, but there's a proposed offshore wind site off of New York, just as much off of New Jersey, sort of up to the north. And when BOEM put out its original plan, it actually amended it a little bit and did cut out some areas, saying that they looked at the ocean data portal and they thought that these were definitely not suitable. I think the fisheries would have liked them maybe to take more areas out of it. But there is examples now which you're starting to see that kind of interchange among the agencies and also with the public. Another question? Yep, sir.
Hi, Mark. I have an Navy background, so I have a question about funding and risk assessment. So if you've got better data, and that's good, and you're cooperating, and it's more on computers and it's more real time, it seems like you could co-op requirements in all these entities that have money, like the federal government has money, they have to do risk assessments, they have to do, the companies have to do environmental impact statements, the states have Department of Environmental Protection. So if you are actually able to sort of co-opt or facilitate earlier reviews, maybe just by being active and making sure it's thorough, that could co-opt some of that money that they need to spend to make sure it's sort of an optimal, whatever.
Let me start off that a little bit, because can I take you with me to Washington? Because we're actually having that discussion right now. One of the actions in the plan is to continue to support the Ocean Data Portal and use of it. Another action in the plan, and you know these processes, is actually for the agencies to agree to guidance how they will use that as essentially first-level information. You're almost every NND specific project going to want more information than there. But it's a first-tier level review that, as you said, would go into NEPA or some of the other reviews. So we are trying very much an efficiency of decision-making point that we're trying to make with this. And that's exactly how it's designed in the Ocean Action Plan. Convincing agencies to then reallocate money that they're saving as a result of that, or industry, if you'd come with me and help make that argument, we'd love to do that. They should, and leave me your card, please, because no, we are looking, actually trying to figure this out, because we are trying to make exactly that case about the efficiency, the effectiveness, to save money not only to the agencies but also to the applicants and the private sector folks who are looking for their permits. So that's exactly the way this was designed and the way it is supposed to work. We're trying to do that. I don't know if we heard some comments about DC. I haven't asked too much about that, but right now proposed budgets in science and management programs are really under threat. We don't really know how this is going to play out, but although the agencies are continuing to collaborate in this regional planning body, they're all a little bit walking on eggshells because they do not know what their mandate is going to be. They just don't know. Forget EPA, that's a whole debate in and of itself. But NOAA, ocean management, fisheries science, you know, which everybody agrees, a cooperative research, which is there's the consensus across the regulated and the managed community that we need to invest in that, where it's all very, very, very uncertain right now. Does anybody want to add anything else to that?
No, I think you nailed it. Just call the congressman and tell them that you're
there's some opportunities out here. I think some people have some ideas, and we'll try to follow that out. If we can go to the back there, please.
Get on their backs, and that's the only way we're going to be able to change things today. So that's my suggestion to you, that this film should go out to every group that possibly could see it on a smaller scale, of course.
I appreciate that. And if you look at the Ocean Frontiers website, you will see that they can arrange for screening, they can arrange together. There's shorter versions of this. I think there's a 5-minute version, but so you can do that. So please look at that site. I think there's information outside that Eva can talk to you, and it's over there. So that would be great. I will mention, with regard to the engagement, we work with many of the partners here, I mean, throughout this process. And for the portal itself, which is my particular niche in this game, we already have some training materials. Anybody can sign up and figure out how to use it. It's pretty intuitive. We've worked hard to do that. And we're actually scheduling a series of outreach and training meetings for different constituencies, including the conservation community, so also the agencies and others. So stay tuned. There will be opportunities to get involved and learn about it. And on the advocacy side, there's many groups and partners, I think, who are better positioned than myself anyway to really carry that message.
Right. So if you're motivated tonight, there's a petition out there at the Littoral Society's table. If my colleague Helen Henderson put her hand up, you can talk to her as well. And we are sending out an email blast to about 15,000 people tonight, asking them to write to their Congress and Senate, you know, representatives. If you want to be on that list, leave us your email address. We'd be happy to keep you linked in to, as much as anybody understands what's going on down there at the moment, getting that information out to you.
Starting Monday, they will all be in the district. This is a 2-week break, so you have time to stop by their offices and say hello. I mean, or you find out to an event they are, and you stop by and talk to them, because they're there to basically listen to you. And it especially helps when you basically show up in the district that you're supposed to be in.
Right.
When I go into another district, congressional, state, I always bring somebody that lives in that district, because they want to know what the resident of that district basically feels about this. So that's important.
Great. Sir?
I'm a policy briefer. talk to to help fix this, that would be really great.
I agree, Kevin. I imagine you're sort of, but as a member of the Baykeeper Board, I absolutely agree with that very, very strongly. So that's something that we've been working hard. And I do think that people just not aware of the potential upside of investing in these kind of things. It's just not broadly understood. Sir.
I'll just point out the problem with oysters, and I'll quick example. Congressional hearing in Belmar 20 years ago. We're sitting there, Congressman Flohn's basically doing it, it's on striped bass. We finish the hearing. We give out an open mic to the audience, we stop the transcript and everything else. And the first, because we're gonna make striped bass no sale. The first person that gets up is from Belford, and he basically says, Congressman, I have to be able to sell striped bass for all the fines I get for clamming and condemned waters. That was the serious concern up in Raritan Bay, was basically, they have a tendency to do that, they have a tendency. And the oyster shellfish industry in New Jersey, is, as DEP could point out to you, is very important. It's one of the biggest fishery economies in the state. And we are such under scrutiny that all you need is one hepatitis oyster, one bad oyster, anything.
We can not all agree exactly with that characterization, but that I've heard that concern expressed before. Any other, can we get any other questions down here, please? Great perspective. Good, great question. Thank
so,
you. Can I just back it up too?
Yeah.
I end up by saying, no, and I really don't want to see women come by because if you did a study and said to everybody, turn off the light in their house, and they do this one off, we don't need this machine out there. I don't need to see this. I want to see the ocean. I want to see this machine. And who's talking about that? Why can't we just say, hey, New Jersey, turn off one light in your basement, off in your garage,
energy policy is good, but thoughts about how to engage big business in a way that they get behind this and support it, particularly listening to other stakeholders?
Well, I think there's a pragmatic opportunity in this process in that if we fight out and discuss and fight out some of these questions beforehand, put them in a plan which gets followed, then when these companies come along, the regulatory process should be quicker, more efficient, and therefore less costly. And I think that's how you appeal to business, right? Is that they have an economic interest in getting these projects done quickly, not spending 11 years and then litigating the location of a wind farm. And if, because the process provides an opportunity for the public and stakeholders to put input into this. If there's a consensus that the farm should be 20 miles offshore where they're out of sight, and in a place where there's less conflicts with other uses, then perhaps that consensus gets embodied into the plan, and therefore the regulatory process is guided that way. So that's, you know, there's a lot of idealism and love of the ocean, I think, that are in these plans, which can be sound very bureaucratic, very governmental, right? But if you think about what they're really trying to do, they're trying to protect special places, trying to ensure that the whales, you know, don't have to run an obstacle course when they go from north to south or south to north. They're trying to make sure that fishermen have a place to continue to fish in the future. are trying to make sure that we can make a contribution to dealing with climate change, right? But it gets packaged up in these very governmental type processes. But there is a lot of hope embedded in all that bureaucracy, if you want to look at it that way. And I think, you know, again, I think there's some very self-interest motivated aspects and outcomes that can come through this planning process. And really what this whole, you know, effort is about, and Eva's films and all the outreach is to help people understand that those opportunities are there, but we have to engage around it. So
I gave Eva a little sheet that's sitting there looking at. When you look at the statistics, recreational fishing alone in New Jersey, we have 1.1 million anglers. If I ever could vote, get those mobilized and listen, you imagine the voting block that is. And that's been my job for 30 years, trying to organize those anglers to basically participate. What's even more interesting than those 1.1 million, because that's in-state anglers. They're coming into New Jersey because that was done by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. And I have copies of the newsletter, you can take a look at it. But every congressman in the state has at least 50,000 anglers in their district. Lobiondo and MacArthur have 95,000. And it's interesting, even who was I looking at? One all the ways up north, Frienhuysen still has 45,000 anglers in his district, or some figure like that. I might be off you. So that's the population I'm looking at. We couldn't communicate. I used to put out a newsletter with apps and with everything. And I shouldn't be the one talking about this because I still have a flip phone. But I know that I need to get we now have at least a Facebook, the association on Facebook. We have to learn how to Twitter. You notice my name wasn't there for Twitter. Yeah, we're using the cables. Because we have the opportunity to get some, you know, as Paul Eidemann, Captain Paul Eidemann is working on protecting menhaden. He says, you know, I get all the fishermen involved, but just think when the whales were eating menhaden in New York Harbor, we got these people motivated now that are not fishing, not anglers, but they're basically looking at protecting the resource. Because the whales are bigger than the fish, because they can't stand, maybe they don't understand striped bass, but they understand a whale jumping and eating menhaden. So that's the way I'm looking at it. I'm always an optimist. I have to be Don Quixote to do this type of job, especially as a volunteer, because you're always chasing windmills.
Give them a sense of how big what your industry is, and how much does it cost to put on a cable? How big is the undersea cable industry?
It's big. So there's about a million kilometers of cable around the world right now. Just as an example, a transatlantic cable, because it has to have electronics, optical amplifiers every 100 kilometers or so, may cost maybe $200 million to put one in. So it's not something that individuals can do. You know, there's consortiums and private investors that do that. But to answer your question, by the way, you must have voted for Jimmy Carter, because he was a big advocate of turning lights off and wearing cardigans. I voted for Jimmy too. I think we still need regulation to prevent sort of bad things from happening. You know, there has to be rules about. I'll take my industry, cables. Where cables, my bosses would probably won't want. Like me saying this, but there has to be rules about where cables are laid, that we do environmental impact assessments, and we do it in the correct way. And likewise with wind, I mean, we're regulated by Army Corps of Engineers. I know the wind, I'm not in the wind industry, but wind cables and farms are regulated by BOEM, so they look after that. There's consultation with NOAA and fisheries, and that all happens even outside of this ocean planning process, but these ocean regional planning boards make it more efficient and more collaborative, I think, is what's happened.
I guess what I'm thinking, okay, does Randall Stevenson, for instance, pay mine to a wonderful group like this and the great data that you're producing?
Who's he? Randall Stevenson?
Sorry, he's the CEO of Facebook.
This is great. I think that's as you're thinking about it, to answer that question, because AT&T does have a cable group in it, but I think you're raising something which I'm struggling with. So we need to do a better job with the blue economy, with the direct, the fishermen, the ports of navigation. They're starting to step up. But you're right, the corporate leaders in this area who have much bigger fish to fry in some senses. In other words, cable is small for AT&T big. Around here, it's hard to get people's attention on these issues because we're all finance, banking, you know, real estate, insurance. So I do think strategies to get more business leaders in general. You know, GE, the president of GE just came out and talked about climate last week. I think getting the ocean on their agenda as well is something that we need to spend more effort, and I'm thinking about how to do that as well. So it's great to get all the fishermen activists, but I think in this environment right now, bringing some of those people to the table and figuring out how to get those kind of corporate leading spokesmen to really stand up and support a healthy ocean ecosystem would be huge right now. It's hard. It's hard. Yep. It's not just collecting data. That's an element of it. It's the agencies, but nor does this group make that decision. But they will input to BOEM, the Office Bureau of Ocean Energy Management. The inputs will go into them to make those decisions. So we'll inform those kind of actions. But this group, the regional planning body, is a collaborative body that understands that identifies areas of mutual interest that need to be worked on across them. So they really are working on specific actions and informing better decisions under the agency's policies. So those guidelines are in the regulations, their framework, they inform better decisions. That's
what they're doing is providing you as the common citizen, the stakeholder, the advocacy group with the information you need to battle the Army Corps of Engineers or somebody else or BOEM when they're promoting a project that you think will impact your quality of life. And really that's part of the information here. We're putting that information together, the portal's there, you can go pull out facts, the commercial fishermen are doing that, and everybody else can do that to basically look at what they're supposed to be doing. And even for business like the cable, they're looking at, well, I can't put the cable here, how do I get around that? Those windmills, or how do I get around the fishing grounds or the scallop grounds? Am I gonna wind up with a problem with the scallop dredges going through there? Oh, how do I work around that? How deep do I need to go?
Yeah, I took me a while to figure out that question you just asked, that this body is not the regulatory body, but it's led by those heads of those organizations, whether it's BOEM or others that will, I guess, be informed by the discussion in these bodies and go back to their home office and perhaps put those kind of guidelines in place or advocate for them or not. And maybe Kevin has something.
Well, and I guess the other thing I would just caution everybody to remember, this is a new approach, and it's a process that's in development. It was guided by a national ocean policy that was established by an executive order by President Obama. And in that executive order, there was a directive to the federal agencies that they should, and I don't remember the exact language, but the idea was that they should use these plans to be integrated into their decision-making processes. So it's not advisory, if that's the kind of thought that you're getting in your head, right? There are mechanisms, interjurisdictional coordination devices, or all these approaches that are implementation of this plan, right? And at least under the Obama administration, there was envisioning that these plans would be very central to the way agencies made their decisions. The distinction between planning and regulation is that the agencies have organic statutes, laws that they operate under, that allow them to promulgate those regulations, right, exerting their authority over some private action. And these plans should guide that. So it should be real, right? And we should all be intersecting or interacting with this process to say, all these things that we want to see happen that are in the plan, whether it's a healthy ocean ecosystem or sustainable uses, we need to make that real. So it can't be just advisory. But that's a chapter, that's sort of the story interrupted, right? Because now we have a difference of administrations and a very different perspective on how federal agencies ought to operate. So it just, in my mind, doubles down on the need for the public to say, look, we see what's going on, we see what's on the horizon, and we need to make sure that we're taking steps to protect those things that we think are important in the ocean, and find ways to allow the things to happen that we think are appropriate to happen out there.
Great. I think I want to respect the time here. Maybe one more question from the back, and then we'll wrap that up, and we'll do that. Yeah, please.
Hi, my name is Sarah. One of the things that you had is sort of an activist around raising awareness of the changes that we need to make in lifestyle due to climate change. I've been involved with film screenings about environment, about the big picture environmentally. And, you know, you hear these very dire statements coming from the marine biologists. I won't go on at length, don't worry. But I'm going to talk about 90% of the fisheries are collapsing, and the oceans are not only warming but acidifying. And I guess I didn't hear that really reflected so much in the film, which anyway alluded to, sea level rise was mentioned in the panel. But what I'm wondering, way off phrase the question, is are there things that are coming to your awareness through this research, this portal that is challenging to engage the public around? Is that something that, you know, like, there was the child who spoke at the end of the film alluded to lifestyle changes, you know, as far as how much meat and fish are we consuming, which is, you know, a question of livelihood for people in this room and many others. But I was just wondering, how do we navigate this, you know, the new world that we
So I'll let Tom, I'm sure he has some comments on it, but I'll just mention a couple things. I do think one of the specific actions under this is we actually are establishing a Mid-Atlantic Coastal Acidification Network. We realize that there's not a lot of good information about that. That's out there, and that's actually one of the implementation actions is to bring more attention to that issue and understand it better. There's some issue about these kind of data that you cite that is scientifically challenging because most acidification information is at a global scale, and making it we are trying to make this regionally relevant. So, Tom, please don't debate everything about the 90% of the fish law. But some of those are global numbers. So we are trying, that is information that's relevant. We are focusing on regionally relevant information that we can downsize to do that. So I think there are ways to have that discussion. We are specifically trying to work even more closely with Mid-Atlantic Fisheries Council, Mid-Atlantic Council really deserves a lot of credit. They really are one of the, you know, can raise concerns, for sure, but they really are leaders with regard to considering ecosystem-based management and considering how do you think about things about the health of habitat. So there are opportunities to think of some of those things. So we hope that you'll find that issue that is significant to you and also push the lifestyle changes. That's not the objective of this, but it might be a reasonable outcome or reaction to the information that you get. Everyone want to add to that?
Yeah. I felt a little hope about 3 weeks ago in the New York Times, because I've been running around talking about a topic that nobody wants to pay any attention to for years. And there was an article in the New York Times about the study in China about basically looking at sperm donors from men and looking at the fact that they went from 53% of them viable to basically be donating sperm is now down to 18% viable. Now, why am I saying that? Because we've been looking at fish populations and bays and estuaries and endocrine disruptors. I'm an Agent Orange vet. I mean, and one of the reasons I got involved with Jersey Coast was because we were fighting ocean dumping of dioxin and things like that. So I've been yelling and testifying before Congress. But now that we find it in men's sperm that it's causing a problem, maybe I can get somebody activated. You know, we always look at the story that we have one man that's viable with sperm to produce the whole population of the world. Well, that's my fear also, is that we're going to basically do it. We're changing the sex of fish. We're changing males into females. And that's part of the reason we're not rebuilding stocks. We do all the management measures of a lot of species. I've been doing this for 27 years on the Atlantic States, which is the compact of the 15 states. We handle state waters. We've done everything right with a couple of species. Winter flounder, we put almost a moratorium. Weak fish, moratorium. They haven't come back. There's other reasons. It's not fishing pressure. There's other reasons that are affecting those fish. So those are the issues we have to work on.
And when you see those kinds of signs, you get some hope because maybe more people will get involved.
Okay. Any other last panels from anybody else on the panel? We're good? No. Yep. Great.
I'll hang around for a while. I'll be here.
Great. So join me, please, in thanking the panel tonight. Thanks, Ava, for bringing the film, and thank you all for coming out. So have a great night. Thank you very much.